Coastal wetlands are among the most biologically productive natural systems on Earth. Salt marshes are the lifeblood of our estuaries and are important drivers of our economy and our way of life. They also filter pollutants, serve as nurseries for fish, and provide habitat for a variety of plants and animals. But their health is threatened in many ways, including nutrient pollution, sea level rise, and invasive plants. Another threat to coastal wetlands today is the effects from dragline ditching that took place decades ago to reduce salt marsh mosquito populations. From the 1950s through the early 1970s, large excavators called draglines cut extensive networks of deep, wide ditches through coastal wetlands and piled the spoil in mounds between the ditches. This practice created areas that were always dry or always wet, thereby interrupting the life cycle of salt marsh mosquitoes. Dragline ditching reduced the salt marsh mosquito populations in coastal wetlands, but it also created unintended alterations and reductions in valuable ecosystem services, including fewer resources for fish and wildlife and less protection from waves and surge from storms. The effect of these old dragline ditches, combined with sea level rise, continue to cause the loss of wetlands to this day. Some wetlands we had last decade are now gone, and some we have today will be gone in the years ahead. The St. Johns River Water Management District, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission, and the Florida Department of Environmental Protection State Park System and Aquatic Preserves, and other partners are working together to reverse the damage done to coastal wetlands. Through such partnerships, the district has successfully restored more than 600 acres of dragline ditch-impacted wetlands in Volusia County, including Tomoka, Bulow, and North Peninsula State Parks, and the Mosquito Lagoon. These partners recently initiated a project to restore dragline ditch-impaired wetlands in Flagler County. The 113-acre project in Flagler County is located on state lands, including a portion of Gamble Rogers Memorial State Recreation Area, and is adjacent to the Tomoka Marshes Aquatic Preserve. The entire project will occur on state-owned lands. The plan has been developed in consultation with DEP Aquatic Preserve and State Park staff. All work will occur within the historical footprint of previously disturbed coastal wetlands, and all necessary permits have been obtained from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and the Florida Department of Environmental Protection. The restoration will consist of moving the spoil piles back into the ditches and grading the spoil to match the elevation of nearby remnants of natural wetland. No natural upland will be excavated or disturbed, and the project will avoid oyster reefs and existing wetlands. Along with district sources, funding for the project includes a nationally competitive grant from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service that passes through the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. This funding is combined with the matching funds from FWC and a contribution from the Florida Department of Environmental Protection through the Florida State Park System. These partners all support the Flagler County Wetland Restoration Project, citing the successful restoration of more than 600 acres of coastal wetlands in the region. It is well documented that when coastal marshes are restored, there is more space for wading and shorebirds and greater production of the plants that provide food for shrimp, crabs, and fish. Other benefits include more native wetland plants, such as black mangroves, and less undesirable invasive vegetation, such as Brazilian pepper plants.
The restoration technique represents, in our minds, the perfect balance of habitat restoration while still providing for mosquito control. We have literally broken them into pieces. And with this technique, we're able to put them back so that you have a better reflection of the way that they used to be in terms of nutrient uptake, production of fisheries. Remember, it's the young plants that take up nutrients, not the old ones.
Stakeholders who have experienced similar restoration work nearby say that after some initial anxiety, they already can see the benefits to the environment and the fishery.
How do we improve this? So I know the people working on this project, their goal, number one, is save oysters, improve water quality. Right away, we might not all see eye to eye on the best way to get there, but there's probably more education that we need to do. But we feel confident this is a good project and support it. Thank you.
The team that we've got and that you have on this is really an A team. They're phenomenal biologists. They want the same things that this group wants. I mean, we all want the same thing.
Recognizing interest by stakeholders, including neighboring residents and commercial and recreational anglers, the agency partners are working to provide up-to-date information and answer questions about the project, its benefits, and the day-to-day operations it entails. Meetings with local government officials and residents, district governing board meetings, community workshops, a project webpage, and a dedicated email address are all intended to assure that stakeholders are informed about the project and are given opportunities to express interest and share ideas. There are some frequently asked questions about the project. How was the project site selected? Is the water quality here impaired? What is the recovery time for a project like this? What will the finished project look like? Will I be able to catch fish? What kind of equipment is being used and how loud is it? The site in southern Flagler County was identified as a candidate because it met key criteria such as being degraded due to dragline ditching. The site is further degrading as the remaining patches of wetland convert to less productive open water. Additionally, the project area is entirely on state-owned land and it is just north of an area where previous restoration has been successful. These waters were declared impaired by the Florida Department of Environmental Protection in June 2018. The impairment is due to high concentrations of chlorophyll A, which correlate with the amounts of alga in the water. Alga require nutrients, so the impairment can be traced back to inputs of nitrogen and phosphorus delivered by discharges of wastewater, stormwater runoff containing fertilizer, groundwater containing leachate from septic tanks, and other sources. According to data collected by the FDEP, at sites shown on the map as green dots, average concentrations of chlorophyll A in the water over the last 13 years exceeded the target concentration by approximately 2 to 3 times. Eventually, local stakeholders, such as the City of Flagler Beach and Flagler County, will participate in development and adoption of water quality standards called Total Maximum Daily Loads, or TMDLs. A plan to achieve nutrient reductions, termed a Basin Management Action Plan, or BMAP, also will be developed and adopted. How long will it take for the project site to recover? Initial revegetation happens very quickly, within a few months. As an example, similar sites at the Marin Island National Wildlife Refuge had 10 to 30% cover by 6 months and 50 to 80% cover by 18 months. Response may vary due to weather, availability of plants to recruit to the area, and other factors not related to the restoration process. What will the project look like during and after construction? Here's an example of a similar coastal wetland restoration project. The project is designed to increase the productivity of the marsh by maximizing the intertidal footprint, which occurs between the tides. Multiple studies show that the intertidal marsh plants provide energy, habitat structure, and protection for resident prey fishes and small juvenile of fishery species such as snook, redfish, mullet, blue crabs, and edible shrimps. In their current state, the dragline marshes are not as productive and resilient to adverse effects such as storms as they could be with restoration. This is also true for the fish populations that they support, especially because the deep dragline channels allow adult predators to access the nursery. It is true that some of the ditches will become more shallow and larger fish will move to other deep areas, but the restored condition maximizes marsh production while providing protection for juveniles to thrive and grow.
And we support the completion of these sorts of comprehensive restoration programs because we know, based on scientific literature, a study that was done, in fact, in Volusia County, that every acre of pristine salt marsh produces about 50 pounds of fishes per year.
The project calls for the restoration to be formed by an amphibious excavator mounted on pontoons. This is a self-crawling, track-driven vehicle often called a marsh buggy. This type of vehicle only generates approximately 2 pounds per square inch of pressure on the ground because its weight is distributed over the entire bottom of the pontoons. This amount of pressure is comparable to a person standing on 1 foot. Thus, the equipment can move across a wetland without causing damage. In this process, there is no grinding or pounding, just clearing plants and moving soil. The noise from the diesel engine of the marsh buggy is comparable to engines in standard excavation equipment. The work will be done far enough from homes that sound impacts are anticipated to be minor, equivalent to the sound of human conversation or lower. This type of equipment generates sound at a level of 99 decibels right next to the engine. Homes closest to the work area are more than 160 feet away. Based on safety expert calculations, at that distance, the noise level would be no greater than 55 decibels. Since the homes closest to the work area are more than 160 feet away, it is unlikely that residents in their homes or yards or on their docks will experience significant noise issues. Additionally, the restoration contractor is limited to working between 7 a.m. and 6 p.m., with no work occurring on holidays or weekends. These and many other questions have been addressed on the project webpage, at meetings, in emails, and one-on-one conversations. But perhaps the most important question is this: what if we did nothing? The do nothing option means further wetland loss in the area. This degraded wetland will continue to degrade. The remaining patches of wetland will convert to less productive open water. Less wetland means less filtering and cleaning of water, which is detrimental to a water body that is already not achieving water quality standards due to excess nutrients. The loss of wetlands also reduces habitat and the amount of food produced for fish, birds, and other wildlife, and there will be less buffering against storm damage. The do-nothing option is not the best option for the environment and natural systems, Flagler County stakeholders, or residents. By working together, we can restore these damaged wetlands in Flagler County and improve water quality, the fishery, and plant and animal habitat. Public participation is important to us. Stay up to date via the project webpage, located on the district's website, www.sjrwmd.com, and share your thoughts with us through the dedicated email address. We sincerely look forward to working with you to fine-tune the project design. Thank you for your participation.